grad advisors are one of the most important aspects of success in graduate school. But a major mistake graduate students make when pursuing a grad advisor is just going after the leading scholar in their field. There's just so much more that goes into picking a good grad advisor for you and your research. But in order to make those good decisions, you need to know what is a grad advisor, what are they supposed to do, and how to go after them. So in today's video, we are answering all of those questions. Okay, so what is a grad advisor? Well, I guess in the simplest way, a grad advisor is a faculty member that advises you through grad school. But okay, what I mean is, in a graduate program, you are usually assigned or given or encouraged to pursue a grad advisor. And this grad advisor is supposed to guide you through your grad experience or your graduate process. They are oftentimes assistant, associate faculty members, or tenure track faculty members, but they definitely have to be somebody that's going to be at the university for a really long time. So they can't be lecturers or faculty members that are just temporary, like visiting scholars. They have to be somebody who is very much a part of the institution and the department that you're applying to. And then yes, of course, we all know they're considered experts in our field. And while that is important because they will be the ones that guide you into your discipline or into the field, it shouldn't be the most important thing. And why is that? Well, it's because of what grad advisors are supposed to do. They have a ton more responsibilities than just guiding you into your research. I mean, yes, they are mentoring you in a specific way, and some even better than others. But the reality is, when we're applying graduate school, when we are in graduate school, we have this, I guess, imagination that if we have the best faculty member in the field, that all of their smarts will trickle down into us and then we will become the best. And yeah, sometimes that happens, but generally, if you were going to be the smartest or the best in your field, you're going to be that regardless. And it's not just because your faculty member has mentored you or groomed you to do it. It's because you just are the best, and that's wonderful. So really focusing on trying to be the best or the smartest in your field may not be the healthiest way to approach thinking about a grad advisor, because oftentimes you become vulnerable to being stuck in toxic relationships, unproductive mentorships, or feeling like you have big shoes to fill, and all of that can really impact your mental health and even the quality of your research. So it's important that we're not just idolizing our faculty and trying to emulate who they are, but really being hyper aware of what we are able to gain, be it technical skills, academic professionalization support, or just guidance within our research questions or research methods, but not seeing this person as who we want to be when we become scholars or what we must turn into as graduate students, because that's just not realistic. You are supposed to be your own type of scholar. And like I said, they're doing a lot more than just being your mentor. One of the most important parts of a grad advisor is that they are really there to be your permanent letters of recommendation and references. And so by serving this position, they have to be faculty that are invested in your research, invested in your success as students, and really understand who you are and what your professional, personal, and academic goals are. So it has to be more than you think your faculty is smart, but it also needs to be that they think you're smart and that you deserve to succeed. And I know a lot of people will probably think, well, don't all advisors feel that way? And the answer is heck no. Some advisors go out of their way to sabotage their students, to talk down to them when they don't do things exactly how they do and punish them. And then some advisors haze their students to make them feel like, you know, to succeed in academia, they have to struggle. You don't want that person writing your letter of rec, because they're probably going to include a lot of backhand compliments or some spaces where you can improve. And it just may not be the best reference to speak on your behalf if you have a relationship or a faculty member that just isn't completely encouraging. If you don't feel confident in your relationship with your advisor, or you feel like your advisor doesn't like you, then you shouldn't trust them to write your letters of rec or be your reference for a postdoc or a job. And so that is something that is so important to consider when picking out your grad advisors, because that is their responsibility. And a lot of applications, job postings expect your grad advisors to be a letter of rec. You usually can't turn in an application without the chair of your committee or your grad advisor being a part of the application. Also, your grad advisors are responsible for your exams and just your general progress throughout the program. So if you have a grad advisor who is super duper smart, but also super duper busy and doesn't seem to respond to you when you reach out to them, or forgets to do things that you ask them to do, like turn in your letters of rec, then they may not be a good grad advisor, even though they may be the best person to have in the field vouching for you. If they don't remember to support you, then it makes it really hard to graduate. And it doesn't really matter if the smartest person in the world is on your committee, if you never actually get to graduate, or if it takes you 37 years to graduate and you feel like you're not going to get the type of life that you wanted in the first place. So it's important to realize, in addition to all the academic needs and guiding or mentorship that they're doing, there's also a lot of administrative duties. They're going to set up when your exam dates are. They're going to rally together your committee members. They're going to review and edit your dissertation. They're going to file your dissertation. They're going to fill out paperwork that says you advanced or didn't advance. And so there's all these added barriers that can exist within your graduate process if you have a faculty member that, again, isn't that invested in you or your research, isn't really all that nice, and makes the grad school process really hard for you, or makes you really self-conscious, or just really busy or self-conscious. These are important things to consider because, again, a lot of your grad experience is based off of how cooperative and how encouraging and supportive your grad advisor is. So yes, find the smartest person, sure, but make sure that they are also really into your research and into you as a person. Make sure that they have your best interests at heart and that they are going to support you and help you out when you need it. And then make sure that they're kind of organized, so when you need to do the administrative things like file or prepare your oral exams or schedule your comprehensive exams, you know you have somebody you can depend on. There's nothing more frustrating than writing an entire dissertation, submitting it to be reviewed, and then 3 weeks before you want to graduate, your chair, your advisor emails you back with all these edits and mistakes that they just found within your dissertation because they really just read it. So it's being aware that a grad advisor isn't just giving you their knowledge. They're actually the gatekeeper to a lot of your success in graduate school. But your grad advisor's responsibilities don't just stop at the academic parts. They're also a part of your professionalization. In addition to writing letters of rec and being your references to postdocs or jobs, they should be actively supporting developing professionalization skills while you are in the program. A great example that I have from my committee members and from my grad advisors is that I have told my grad advisors, hey, I want to get published, but I don't know how that process works. Can you help me? Within not even a week and a half of telling one of my committee members this, they emailed me a calling for book reviews and exhibition reviews and encouraged me to reach out to them and say, hey, I will write a book review for you if you publish it. Within 10 weeks, I was published. So those types of little things are very important aspects to being a great grad advisor and helping your graduate students succeed. A lot of people are intimidated to get a PhD because they feel like there's no real jobs once you get out, or that the expectations are unrealistic. But little do we all know is that there's actually, just like an undergrad, a hidden curriculum on how to be successful in your PhD program. And your grad advisors should be actively helping you uncover these hidden curriculum secrets and encouraging you to put yourself out there and do the things that are necessary for you to succeed and to get those professionalization goals. And these just aren't external opportunities either. They should be actively advocating for you to get funding from your department or support from your department. They should be actively encouraging you to participate in conferences or to network with their faculty. I've had my advisor take me to specific private events or private parties so I can meet other scholars working in my field. And let me tell you, faculty members, they know how to party. So having a good variety of different types of advisors on your committee is important, but being hyper aware that your faculty member and how they support you as a whole person is way more important than them just being very smart. You really want somebody who's just, in a very simple way, genuinely nice and genuinely invested in your success. And if that's their personality and that's their MO, then I guarantee your graduate process is going to be so much more generative than if you had the smartest of smart of faculty members who make things harder than what they have to be to prove that that's how you succeed in grad school. It's 2021. We don't need to do that anymore. Academic hazing needs to go out the window because it doesn't help anybody, never has and never will. Okay, sure, so I just told you what is a grad advisor, and I just explained what exactly does a grad advisor do, and all the most important considerations you should take into account when pursuing or asking somebody to be your grad advisor. But now the question is, how do you get somebody to be your grad advisor? Well, okay, in most cases, your first year, you will be assigned one. And the one that you're assigned is usually the one that you requested within your graduate application or the faculty member that was most interested in your research based off of your application. Now, just because you're assigned a faculty advisor doesn't mean you have to stick with that faculty advisor your entire grad process. And I think that's really important just to know is that even though the university or your department might think that y'all are a perfect fit or that faculty member might think y'all are a perfect fit, if it's not a perfect fit for you for the various reasons that I just explained before, then it is totally okay for you to decide that you want to go with somebody else. That is normal, it happens all the time. Don't feel bad, you don't owe them anything. What's important is that you graduate with your mental health, your academics, and your finances all attached. So if you don't get assigned a faculty advisor within your first year, or you do and you want a different one, the next steps on how to pursue a new graduate advisor are pretty straightforward. So you could always cold email, and basically that's just setting up an email, introducing yourself and your research, and asking to meet with that professor during their office hours, or going out for tea or coffee to get to know them and their research more, and then for you to introduce yourself. This is a very informal process. You still want to be pretty academic and professional within these interactions, so nothing too informal in your emails or your interactions when you first meet. But the goal here is just to fill each other out and see what their process is to accepting new students. And so for some faculty, it may be as simple as, you want me, I'll take you. Other faculty, they may require you to take a certain amount of classes or to be fluent in a specific language or what have you. So just being aware of what they expect for people who want to be their students, and then also knowing what you're looking for when you're going to this conversation, so you're able to deduce, would this person even still be a wonderful person to keep as a graduate advisor? I always suggest talk to them a few times before making this decision, unless you're in a dire moment. Because I remember within my second year, I asked a professor to be on my committee, and then after like 3 months of working with them, I totally knew I could never have kept them on my committee. And so it's just really important to like take things slow and get to know your faculty. I mean, it's kind of like dating because you have to be stuck together forever. So just getting to know each other, taking things slow, and really trying to understand your best communication, what your expectations are, and each other's personal and professional goals are a great way to move forward once you send out the email. Now, if you're somebody who's just super nervous and just doesn't want to send an email first, I would suggest attending talks or faculty events or workshops that are being led by this specific faculty member, or you know that that faculty member would be there, and then trying to network or meet with them kind of more organically or naturally and just feel things out in that way. Happens all the time. You'll go to a luncheon and you'll hear a faculty talk and you'll be so impressed or so in love with what they were talking about, and then you go and talk to them afterwards and say, hey, do you want to get coffee? Do you want to get lunch? Do you have office hours? What's the best way that I can talk to you? Are you taking students? And usually if they're not being bombarded by a ton of people, they'll be really kind and answer your questions. And if they aren't kind in those situations, then you kind of see it as a red flag. And maybe you don't want them as your grad advisor. But if you realize a specific faculty member that you really want to get to know or see if could be your graduate advisor doesn't have any workshops or talks or luncheons scheduled anytime soon, and you really want to get to know them as soon as possible, you could always ask if they have any classes on the registrar that you could take. This is a great way to get to know the professor without having to make any commitments, see how y'all communicate, what the kind of chemistry is between you all, a little bit more about their research, their mentorship style, and all of that jazz. And if they don't have a class, you can always ask to do an independent study, do a short reading list, or work on a specific project under them. But building in time to get to know them with these types of structures are very helpful because they have an end date. So if you take an independent study or if you take a class with them and you realize, oh my goodness, this professor is wild and chaotic and hard to please, then after the end of the semester, you can wipe your hands clean and keep it pushing. And I think that's the really most important part about thinking about a grad advisor, is that it really is about what fits and suits your needs the most, your academic, your professional, and your personal. I mean, even though they're not our therapists, grad advisors really do impact our mental health, even our social health in a way. So you need to be really honest with yourself about what this relationship is, how it makes you feel, and what you are and are not getting out of it. So maybe have a pros and cons list or something to reference. But generally, I've noticed from my department, people with kinder, more encouraging grad advisors generally move faster within the program and are just as successful as the people with the super smart, well-developed faculty members as well. So I don't think not picking the most prolific faculty member in the world is gonna keep you from being a successful graduate student, because honestly, all faculty at a university had to have graduated from a PhD and get hired within your department. So it's pretty safe to say that everybody that's there is going to be pretty competent. So really what you're trying to measure is how well you work with somebody and how well you can communicate and really work on your research and professionalization goals. Now, graduate advisors are fundamentally important to your graduate success, and they serve as gatekeepers to your graduate process, but they are not the only indicators of if you're going to be successful or not. So if you're interested in hearing some more grad advice, learning more about grad life and research, don't forget to subscribe. And as always, if you found at least two things useful, don't forget to hit the thumbs up. And please, if you have any questions or video suggestions, leave them in the comments down below. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next week.